and also dealing with the repercussions of that in the morning.
There is so much to discuss right now. David Gergen, John Dean, Asha Rangappa are here. Good evening, everyone. I appreciate you joining. So listen, we heard what he said, but in spite of what he said, in spite of this investigation being so short, the senators haven't even heard or seen, I should say, the investigation, the report. Mitch McConnell's moving forward.
Absolutely. Well, he does what he says, and he plays a real serious game of hardball. Very objectionable in many regards, but he delivers. That's why he's a majority leader.
Why is he moving forward so fast?
To get it done. I don't think he really gives a damn about whether there's a lot of questions about it. That, you know, what he cares about is getting it done. Mm-hmm. But listen, we just heard from a man who had apparently been struggling with his conscience about whether he ought to come forward and do this TV interview or not. Mm-hmm. It took him a while to do that. CNN had to check him out to make sure that his reliability seemed strong. And I think he gave a remarkably credible statement about what happened in the freshman year at Yale. What's astonishing is that the FBI is disinterested in his tale and the tales of at least 30 to 40 other people that these women have recommended to go look at and to talk about. And so we're going to wind up with tomorrow and then on a vote Friday, Saturday, is a situation in which I think the odds favor a confirmation unless somebody shows more backbone than we've seen. And the country's going to feel like we were had. Mm-hmm. You know, we thought this was going to, they were going to push through. They're going to have a full week. They've had 5 days, including a weekend.
Right.
They've had very little time. They've shut the investigation down. And most importantly, they haven't gone to all these witnesses. And when you get a guy like Roach who said, look, I don't remember this, I don't quite remember this, I can tell you this though, and he's lying about his drinking, and that's relevant not only to whether he would forget something like a relationship with Ford, an incident with Ford, but it's also extremely relevant to his truthfulness in front of the committee under oath.
Yeah.
And so that's very just, all of this is very disturbing.
Actually, I want to follow up on something David just said. He said the FBI seems uninterested or disinterested in speaking to people like James Roche. Why is that? Why wouldn't they contact him or someone like him?
You mean right now or back mm-hmm. when?
But now,
before?
And he says,
I mean, we
he
have
says,
six.
Yeah, he said this time and also even in previous background checks, he's never been contacted.
Yes. So I do think it's important to understand that these background checks typically go back 10 years. And so really the time when Judge Kavanaugh's college drinking would have, you know, been within the scope of the background check would have been in one of his earliest background checks, perhaps when he went to clerk for the federal courts or when he joined the Star prosecutorial team. After that, it would have covered later and later periods of his life. And so, you know, that those college days, those references probably would not have been within the scope of those interviews. So that's just to put that out there, since those six background checks are mentioned frequently. In this one, I am, you know, concerned that he hasn't been interviewed, because you want the FBI to interview people like this precisely so they can probe and make sure they get full context for what the person is saying, that they can not only get what they know, but also explore things like motivation and biases and all of the context in order to actually be fair to the person, that the subject that they are speaking about. And I think what we need here is some transparency on exactly what the direction and restrictions were placed on the FBI in this interview, mm-hmm. because in my opinion, I don't believe that the FBI would not follow leads that were logical if they had the freedom to do so.
Okay. John, do you think that there were restrictions? And because remember, John, we were talking about before, they were saying, well, you know, the White House is controlling the investigation and they are determining the scope of the investigation. And then there was an argument on the other side saying, no, the FBI would never allow that. What do you think, John?
Well, it got awfully murky on the front side of the investigation as to what their scope was, their mission, and a lot of confused and conflicting reporting. Don, I had a flashing thought that the FBI cut this short because maybe Mr. Judge fessed up. He was there. His girlfriend said she had been told by him that this had happened. So that was one of the That would be the most amazing result.
That would certainly be a blockbuster.
It would be a blockbuster. But that could explain also why they didn't go further.
There is a rumor like that, John, that's passing around on the internet. But
that is not confirmed, obviously. That's not.
I haven't read it.
It's just a rumor.
Yeah.
I have no reason to believe it to be true.
Yeah. And I think that if do you think that the senators have some idea what's in this report?
I think they probably do. Yeah.
And so that's why they're setting. If anything like that was true, do you think they'd be setting a vote?
The words rigged and fake and sham have been so overused, it's almost difficult to talk anymore about what's going on in Washington and going on. But there is no question but that intentional restrictions were placed on this so-called investigation, and that we, the public, were not told about them. And I do think that going back, I think this question of transparency is really important to rebuild trust in the way we conduct our public business, and to preserve trust in the Supreme Court. This ought to be a much more transparent. We ought to see the report tomorrow.
Yeah.
We ought to see for ourselves, not just selective leaking from one side or the other, taking a phrase and trying to make it into a big headline.
Do you think, Asha, seeing the report, knowing what happens, with the FBI and with other law enforcement agencies, do you think seeing that report would help some people feel better about the results?
I do. Because that report would contain, what derogatory information, if any, the FBI found among the people they interviewed. And it would also reveal, because it would lay out the contents of the interview that they had, whether there were clearly other leads or other people referenced that would have been logical for them to follow up with and weren't. So you wouldn't be able to hide kind of the scope of what they were looking at and what any investigator might do at that point. Alternatively, maybe it would make clear that this was really all they needed to know. So that, I think, would go a long way. And I agree that what is at stake right now is the institutional legitimacy of the Supreme Court.
Yeah.
And to have half the country believe that it's politicized and the fix is in is really the last thing we need right now.
So, John, how does the country react to this, you think, having gone through something similar with Watergate?
Well, I actually saw a justice put on the court during the Nixon years who had dissembled during his confirmation. It was Bill Rehnquist, and it's sort of haunted his reputation with scholars. So it won't be good. As historians look back, I don't think they should jam this through. And we're only having cloture vote initially. That's kind of a test vote. And who knows what will happen during the debate. That's where a lot of this might be flushed out.
Yeah. Thank you all. I appreciate it. Well, the New York Times says that President Trump inherited